Hello, everyone. Welcome to our session on economy, markets, and investments. Our CIO of equities, Mr. Ravi Gopalakrishnan, is the speaker for this session. Ravi has over 3 decades of experience in research and asset management. Without further ado, over to you, Ravi.
Thanks. Thanks, Shweta. And, markets essentially have been, in a massive kind of volatile period. Since the beginning of the war, and I think there are a lot of things, a lot of moving parts, unfortunately, and these are once again events like these makes it extremely challenging to kind of firm up a view and position your portfolios accordingly. And I'll explain to you why, because we knew that interest rates were going to rise and on the back of inflation across the world, and unfortunately, the Federal Reserve also last year were in a completely denial mode, and they did mention that inflation was more transitory. But having said that, I think they were also caught unawares, and then this Russian invasion of Ukraine began, and that put a lot of challenge because inflation started running up, supply chain disruptions, and all of that. Subsequently, RBI also, I think, as a result, in order to tame the Indian inflation, raised rates not too long ago. And as a result of this, I think the markets are now taking a call in terms of what kind of valuations to kind of ascribe to the markets, right? The world is certainly in an uncertain territory right now. And because of the supply chain issues, there's going to be a lot of disruptions that is happening all around Europe, because most of Europe used to use Russian gas for electricity and many other things. And with Russia stopping almost 40% of the supply, they have to switch to alternate fuels, in order to keep their factories running or their power plants running. So, and this is a phase where you will find 1 or 2 quarters, if this thing doesn't get resolved, situation can remain fairly volatile as a result of this. There are also talks of the U.S. heading for a recession, which again, is still difficult to confirm. But certainly, when we look at some of the results of some of the retailers in the U.S., the net profits are down almost 25%. And this is a result of a massive cut in the discretionary spending. People are postponing because, the real challenge is that most of the Western world haven't really seen what inflation is. They were all used to this 1 or 2, 3% kind of inflation over the last 30, 40, 50 years. This is the first time they're seeing 7, 8, 9% kind of inflation. And obviously, people are unable to even come to terms with it, and that is the reason why there is a massive cut in discretionary spending, because essentials anyway you'll have to spend. And secondly, I think the world is also staring at issues regarding food grain shortage, etc., because Ukraine used to supply a large quantum of wheat to the rest of the world. So, even that is coming under a lot of pressure. And hence, you're seeing wheat prices actually go up 40% in the last few months. So, this is going to remain a challenge for some time, primarily because, none of those economies really understand what shortage is, what food shortage is. It's going to be a big challenge for them to really go through this phase. On the other side, if you actually see, look at India and some of the other economies, I think India will also get impacted, but I think the degree of impact possibly could be far lower, you know, compared to what the West is going through. Primarily because, you know, we have this neutral stance and we continue to have a barter kind of trade with Russia. And also, you know, we already negotiated on the oil and gas front. Oil may not be a problem as such, but gas could be a little bit of an issue because of the lack of liquidification of gas at Russia's end. And we don't have pipelines, right? So the only way is to liquefy the gas and then transport it to India. So, you know, there are multiple challenges, but compared to the rest of the world, I think India will still come out reasonably better. Primarily because of, you know, not only the relationship with Russia, but also I think our economy seemingly is far more resilient in terms of absorbing all of this. Yes, inflation is going to be a challenge, but I think both RBI and government, as we have seen in the last few weeks, are taking all steps necessary to tame down this inflation. So if things don't deteriorate further from here, then, you know, things will be fine. I think from a commodity cycle perspective, you will see specifically the metals, you know, some of the other commodities, steel, aluminium, copper, and some of the other raw materials, those prices will come down, you know, because of the demand scenario globally. Not only that, India took, you know, steps in terms of export ban and all of that. So that should also help in rein prices. So that's positive for the industry in a way, you know, for the manufacturing industry. But what could be a little challenging for India will be oil prices. I think globally oil prices are expected to move up, you know, and because, you know, there is not much supply there. If you take Russia out of the equation, it's going to be very difficult for the world to manage or replace that supply very, very quickly. So, and they have to do that before the next winter, because winter is when the demand for gas and oil, you know, really shoots up. So I think oil probably may remain firm, but rest of the commodities probably, you know, will see some bit of correction, you know, which is essentially good for India. Now, talking about India, obviously, we have seen the fourth quarter results, you know, the way it is positioned. A lot of the companies, you know, you're not seeing too much of impact yet in terms of the operating margins. Yeah, that's primarily because the companies themselves carry at least 1 or 2 months of inventory. So because of that, you know, the operating margins or the cost side of it has not seen much of inflation yet. Although it has seen on a year-on-year basis, you've seen prices actually move up quite sharply, but it is not completely reflecting because of this inventory scenario. As we move into quarter one and quarter two, I think the real impact of that will be seen. And as our interaction with a lot of companies, you know, they're telling us that they are unable to now increase prices because of the demand destruction. Because, you know, people will stop buying if they really increase prices significantly from here on. So there is still a 8 to 10% deficit, at least till day before yesterday it was there. But now with metal prices actually correcting quite significantly, I think, you know, that gap of 10% probably will come down to 4 or 5%, which is quite reasonable. So over the period of next 3 to 4 months, you know, they will probably increase prices gradually. So which is why I said, you know, India, although will be in a challenging spot for the next 1 or 2 quarters, I think demand will slow down, margins will come under pressure, and hence equity markets essentially will have to reprice whatever is going on. Already it has happened to a fair extent, but I wouldn't rule out another leg of downturn, probably if the situation doesn't improve from here on. So that's the way I would view the markets at this point in time. But having said this, I think there are a lot of positives that are going for India. And I think the biggest positive is the, once again, you will see a massive push towards, diversifying the supply chain globally. So India is right at the forefront in terms of the supply chain. Still a long way to go, but certainly a lot of companies are gearing up for that. So although there will be, production issues within Europe, but certainly India can step in and plug that gap quite significantly. So that's one big positive. So manufacturing as a sector should essentially do very, very well. The second area, again, is apart from the being the supply chain, is the food and agri side. You have seen a massive raw material inflation getting fed into food prices, and one of the main reason is that because fertilizer prices and fertilizers and chemicals and pesticide, all the ingredients that the farmer uses, the prices have really gone up. Hence, the farm gate price has also gone up quite significantly. What the government may do at a later stage is probably increase MSPs. And once the MSP kind of goes up, it is going to put a lot of money at the hands of the farmer. And this money probably and most likely will get spent on consumer and consumer discretionary items that we have seen last 2 years. Farm income was quite subdued, and hence, the entire consumer pack did not really participate significantly in the market, especially FMCG. So you might see that FMCG companies actually doing well. So as a result, I think that's one sector to watch out for. Similarly, banking is another sector where we believe, prices have corrected a lot. It's not because of any fundamental reason, because if you actually look at the numbers, most of the banks have done significantly better over the last few quarters. The credit cost problem and the bad debt, bad loan problem, is everything is behind. And they were on a cusp of improving the loan offtake, credit demand in the system was slowly, gradually going up, which is why 4Q, you saw a lot of banks declare excellent results. Unfortunately, from a price perspective, the entire banking sector is coming under a lot of pressure because it is the largest sector. And the FII ownership in all of this, the entire banking sector is huge. Right, just like, because it's part of the benchmark and benchmark has got a lot of weight. So there has been, and they are liquid stocks. So there's been a massive sell-off across banking. But this provides wonderful opportunity for investors like us because the next rally will be led by banking. And whenever that happens, right, in the next two or three quarters, whenever there is a rally, I think we will see banking lead from the front. It's a large sector, and doing extremely well. So these are some of the pockets where where we see tremendous opportunities. Apart from the industrial manufacturing, consumer discretionary, banking, etc. From a portfolio point of view, we are quite overweight on all these sectors except the FMCG sector. So we are continuously reviewing our portfolios and watching out for companies where there is any structural issue, anything which is short term. We are simply using this opportunity to add to the weights, but anything which is slightly more structural or longer term, we are either exiting or reducing weight and slowly shifting weights towards the FMCG sector. So, you know, we are kind of rebalancing the portfolios across the board. But having said this, I think, you know, it's a very dynamic market. It's a very, very volatile market. So, which is why, you know, the performances are also moving quite dramatically for us, not only for us, but for everybody. But you know, given the fact that the markets are so challenging and our portfolios are not defensive, think about it, you know, we believe in the India story. We believe in the growth story. Hence, our portfolios are more positioned, you know, towards growth. And unfortunately, because of the large FI selling, you know, most of the stocks, you know, that they own are coming under a lot of pressure. And, you know, we have also a few of them, like banking, we are overweight, you know, obviously a lot of stocks come into that sector. Similarly, consumer discretionary, similarly manufacturing, you know, a lot of good quality stocks are coming under pressure. So hence, I believe that if the markets remain like this, extremely volatile, then the portfolios may underperform for slightly more longer time. We've already seen some underperformance in the last few weeks, but it may further extend that underperformance for maybe one or two more quarters. But what I would like to assure you is that, you know, when this thing is over and, you know, when things starts to revive, it is these sectors that will lead from the front in terms of any market recovery. So, you know, we will use this opportunity to build our positions, you know, average our holdings, increase our weightages in some of these sectors, and while, you know, making changes to some of the other sectors as well.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.